Sister Becky, God, we ask you, Lord, to bless her family at this time of suffering that you went through with, Lord. They grieved when they saw you suffering as you were. And Lord, as they saw her suffering and knowing, God, that you was going to take her from them. Lord, I pray now that you would be with us during this time of singing and rejoicing together and maybe some words of comfort, hopefully. And Lord, bless you, pray, and have your way throughout this evening service on this, and bless this family. Encourage them, Lord, lift them up. Bless the song, so may it bring glory and honor to the name of the Lord Jesus. And thank you for all you do for us. We ask these things in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Over Jordan, take my hand. read a scripture you read many times. John chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's some good news, don't you think? I do. I believe that's good news. You look at the daily record, I still think it's what I still call it, the daily record. I've done this past one the other day. And turn the TV on, it's always something bad. But I want to tell you today that there is a God who loves you and me and everybody else. And he made a way for us to have eternal life. And we'll get to that a little bit later. Right now we've got a song.
Before I sing, the family asked me if I'd say a few words, and I'm going to do my best. In 1996, my mother went to work at the hospital, and my family met Miss Becky Gibbs from that point on. And always being a family friend, and you know, I say through growing up through high school and going to college and getting married and having a child, Miss Becky was always part of it, always there, always sent a message through mother to me and my brother Joey. And she's just always been a friend to our family. And about a month, I guess been a little over a month, Miss Becky called me and she says, "Justin," she says, "we need to sit down and talk." I said, "Okay, we can do that." So everything that you see going on this evening and been going on last night, Miss Becky had her final say, had her final words. And not many people get to do that. I mean, not many people get to say what they want and how they want it because they don't get the opportunity. And it's such an honor that I could sit down with her and her tell me what she wanted and for it to be fulfilled. And I got thinking about Miss Becky today, and y'all gonna have to forgive me for just a minute. I'm gonna get through this. I don't like to talk much like this, but kind of thinking about Miss Becky, and I thought about, I said, what is a scripture that I could read about Miss Becky that speaks about Miss Becky, that talks about her? And this is what he gave me. It's in Matthew, and it's in chapter 6, and it starts with verse 19. And it says, "Do not lay up for your treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up your treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And I think that speaks for Miss Becky, because when I would go visit at the hospital at mom in the office and would see Miss Becky interact with the patients and see her interact with her families, she loved people. And she put her treasures here, up in heaven, not here. Miss Becky didn't have a lot here on earth, but she had her family, and she laid her treasures where they belonged. And as of the other day, she's been rewarded for those things that she did here on earth. But in her request that she gave us that day, she asked me to sing. So she says, "You got to make sure that, number one, you look after me, and number two, you got to sing." I said, "I can do my best." So she asked me if I would sing Amazing Grace, and so that's what we're going to do.
Saved a wretch like me.
grateful today for this opportunity we have to bring this message to the family here. When we was young and growing up, we never thought about this day to come to be here. What did he dream about? Didn't even think about it. Well, he didn't like to think about it, you know. But it's come to you, to me here, Bob. And but I went to visit Becky the other day, and while she was at home, she couldn't talk, had to have Cindy to interpret it for me. And I said, "How you doing?"
"Sure."
I said, "Are you saved?"
"Yes."
She said. And she said something that was profound. "And I ain't mad at nobody. Leave this world and got a grudge in your heart against somebody, that's going to hinder you." And but I want to talk to you just a few minutes about God's love and compassion. We don't ever think about that much, do we? A lot of people think that God's up there with a big stick and knock in the head if you want to. He loves you. He loves you and wants you to have eternal life. But I thought about this message and what should I speak? I know there's going to be some folks here that probably won't believe me, but it's okay. I started saying a hellfire and a brimstone preacher, but. Sometimes we might get stirred up. Now I want to share some good news with you. Good news is great to hear good news. I hear so much bad news all the time. I'm glad to hear some good news. But let me share first of all bad news with you. In Romans chapter 3, verse 23. And it talks about here, it says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You, me, everybody else, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. That word there means short. It means you missed the mark. I never could shoot a bow and arrow. The arrow always goes somewhere else. But I always missed the mark. My life missed the mark. My life missed the mark. And it says that we've all sinned and come short of that mark. And there's a penalty because of that. There's a penalty called death because we have missed that mark. You couldn't help you miss the mark. That's the way you were born. You were born to miss the mark. But we have help. We have help. And because we missed that mark, though, there's another scripture I want to read in Romans chapter 6, verse 23. It says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Notice the wages of sin. You work for your wages, don't you? Everybody got a job. You work for your wages. You work for the wages that you begin to make and everything. So, but then it talks about a gift. Wage is not a gift. A gift is a gift. And it comes from God. A gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. There is a gift there, but you have to trust Christ to get this gift. You have to trust Him. And so I thought about this, the wages versus gift. I know my job I had used to, when I worked a public job, I loved paydays. So we go out to Win Dixie at that time. Win Dixie, that tells you how old I am. Wiggly. We call him Hoggy Woggy sometimes. But anyway, I'm just cutting up a little bit here. But anyway, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. And I'm glad when we got that check, you know, from working and everything, we go buy our groceries, pay our bills and things like that. Jesus paid our bill. He died on the cross to save us, every one of us. And he ain't gonna leave nobody out either, every one of us. If you don't know Jesus Christ today, and you die from it, and you will, you know where you're gonna spend eternity at. Becky made it right. She told me she made it right with God. She had that relationship with him. And it's good to have a relationship with him who created you. It's good to have a relationship with him that loves you. And talk to him. You can talk to him just like you talk to each other, you know. Because he's your friend. He wants to talk to you. He loves to talk to you. He's just waiting to hear from you. I thought about people who are afraid of this day is coming their way. It's coming. And I think about people who are afraid and they don't know what to do or how to do. But I wanted to share with you Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 13 through 15. The writer of Hebrews says, "And again I put my trust in him. Again, I and the children which God hath given me. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil." Here's the part I want you to listen to. "And delivered them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." Fear of death. It can drag you down. Worry, fearful, because we know that that day's coming. We don't know when or how or where, but that day is coming and we worry about it. We're afraid of it. Remember when I was a kid coming up down Bush Creek area down there, where the old airport sat down. And we talked about that a while ago, the creek down there, we left the fish in that creek. But I remember up on that hill there where we lived at, they had some bad thunderstorms up there. And I remember I felt like crawling into bed sometimes because the whole house was shaking out. Terrible thunderstorm. Daddy worked night for a second shift that caught me a little nervous. And I called out, "Mama, has Daddy come home yet?" Like he's going to save you from something, you know. But, you know, I was afraid. Fearful. Being fearful is a terrible thing. Being fearful is terrible. And so many people are afraid. And they're subject to bondage because of fear. But you don't have to be. You can have that eternal life, that good news of Jesus Christ coming, died on the cross for us to save us from our sin. We have that's good news. That's good news. The little boy went off to youth camp and everybody picked on him. He couldn't talk plain. Couldn't walk very well. Everybody picked on him at camp there. And one day he was waiting for him to get on the bus and he hadn't showed up yet. And they was counseling him over in the place there. And he come back to the bus there. He was happy. He was hollering out, "Good news! Good news! Jesus loves me. Hallelujah. Good news! It is good news. Know that he loves us. Regardless of how dirty, rotten sinners we are, Christ loves us." Amen. He loves us. He died on the cross for us. He,
that, you know, that man let them put him there on us, lay him on the ground and drive spikes through his hands and his feet and then hang him up between heaven and earth and job that thing down in a hole there on that cross, and it just tore his flesh. He did it for us. That not a person living or ever will be or could have ever been. That's what he did it for. That's what he did it for. He did it for you and for me. I'm glad that I made a commitment one day. Went to Vietnam. I told the Lord, I said, Lord, if you'll get me home and keep me safe, let me get home to my wife and my family and everything, I'll serve you. Well, you know how promises are. Got a job, earned done, working on supply place, earned. And one day, something got a hold of my heart. I was in there, you remember the old hand add machine, you punch the belt, you pull the handle, and you hand it. I had one tore down and then I had a bar saw up there cleaning and getting greasy and everything off of it. And all of a sudden, something came down on me. The Spirit of God came down and began to remind me what I promised God that I'd do when I got home. He said, you remember that promise you made? I've got you home safe and sound. And now, what you going to do? And I busted out squalling, not a crying. And I was bawling too. And the guy on the business come running in, he thought I had my hand hanging that ad machine there. I said, man, I got to get saved. And I did. I got saved. And it changed me. It changed me. And gave me hope for the future. Mm-hmm. Gave me hope for the future. And gave me eternal life. And I'm glad today I still know him as my Savior. Perfect. Me perfect? Are you kidding me? Well, don't talk to my wife about that. Okay, please. But anyway, I'm not perfect. But he is perfect. He is perfect. Praise God. But I can remember that bondage of being afraid of dying. I'm not afraid to die, man. I'm not afraid of death. I know it's coming. But I think about Becky, you know. She's in a place now that she would like for you all to be with her. She's having a good time now. She's breathing celestial air. she's breathing that good, clean, heavenly air. She's eating good food. The supper table's been fixed there. She's prepared to eat that good food there. Praise the Lord. God is good to us. Bless us and help us. I want to read another scripture and I'll close with this. It, back to Romans, there, you know, there's a lot of things in this world today that we don't understand. We don't know how to fix. We don't know what to do about it. I've learned out more things I don't understand. I'll leave it up to the politician. You got all the answers. Yeah. I see y'all agree with that. But, I know that God is going to take care of the whole thing. We close with this. In chapter 10 of Romans, a couple of scriptures there, I believe. Chapter 10, verse 9. And this is for those who hasn't made that commitment. You haven't trusted God. This is all you got to do. It said that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Believe it. Believe it.
And then verse 13 said, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You might have killed somebody. I'm not saying you did, but you know, you could have killed somebody. And you know that hell is waiting for people who's evil. The devil has took their mind and warped them and called them in such a place and they know they're going to go out into eternity. But you know what? You don't have to. Man's on an airplane flying. I heard about this. He's on an airplane flying somewhere or another. And he was trying to talk to this guy and set sign on there. And it made the guy mad talking to him about the Lord. He said, won't you go to hell? He says, I ain't going to do it. I ain't going to do it. We don't have to go. If you go there, it's your own fault. It is. It's your own fault. Jesus has paid the price for it. Becky, if she could stand here today and she tell you this is the most wonderful thing that's ever happened to her, going out into eternity, to be the one that she loves and serves. I don't know your heart. I don't know your heart. I know one thing. Jesus loves you. I don't care who you are or what you've done. He is a Savior and will save you from your sin. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But God has made a way for us to be saved. Yes, sir. Let me close with, you notice my in. Injunction there is 15 minutes long. It's still the church there, but anyway. Let me turn to a couple more scriptures now. I promise you I'll hush. This is a blessing. I'm going to read you. This is a blessing. I can't bless nobody. I blessed a few people out from time to time. But this is a blessing. I'm reading through the scripture here. First one is in Jude. Get there in a minute. Jude chapter, Jude 24 and 25. It's a prayer. It is a prayer. It said, now to him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To your only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. This is a prayer for us. It's a prayer for us. And then in Hebrews chapter 13, another prayer. The writer of Hebrews puts this in here. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Praise God. Come this song. Let's close the prayer. Father, we're grateful for what you've done for us. Thank you for the blessings you've given us this day. A day, another day we can enjoy each other's company. God, as we leave this place, we pray that you would remind us of your closeness, your love toward us, your compassion on us. When we're at our lowest point in life, we ask you, Lord, to give us the strength we need to look up to you and to trust you, because you have all the answers for our life. We pray, Lord, that what I've said today wouldn't offend anybody, but help each one that don't know Christ as their Savior come to know you in a great way. Bless each one, Lord. Speak to their hearts and help us all to be a blessing. Bless this family. Pray for Cindy, Jeannie, Willie, Lord, and their families. God, that you be with each one. Help them, Lord, this day. Trust you. And Lord, I just give you praise for all you want to do for us. For we ask it in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. adjacent room, so you can go right to the back of the chapel, go to the left, and you'll be able to speak with them. Thank you so much.